Good evening. You're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. I want to ask a question tonight. Was 9/11 a digital failure? A new book written by James Bamford suggests this possibility. Suppose that all the databases of the government intelligence agencies had been linked. Would it have been any different? And since just recently the government said it is going to link the databases, notice how many years after 9/11, will that make any difference? Here to discuss that question with us tonight is my friend Jim Bamford. Nice to see you again, Jim.
Good seeing you again, Jim.
He's written the book. It's called The Shadow Factory. It's about the NSA. And what's the NSA?
The ultra-secret NSA from 9/11 to the eavesdropping on Americans.
Okay. The big news in your book is that the NSA was apparently eavesdropping on the terrorists. And you went to Yemen and you discovered the Bin Laden Ops Center. We're going to show the audience what that Ops Center looks like. So whereabouts in Yemen is it?
Well, it's just outside the capital, Sana'a. Sana'a is the capital of Yemen. It's just sort of northwest part of the city there.
Is it still the Ops Center now?
No, after 9/11, it was raided by the...
All right, so now you've got several big pieces of news in your book. One big piece of news is that center that we just saw there was talking to two terrorists in San Diego. And when those two terrorists talk to the Yemen center, they use their cell phones. And you assert, I don't know how you know this, but you assert the NSA was listening. Is that true?
Yeah, it's not just what I assert. Actually, the 9/11 Commission.
9/11 Commission had said, oh, I didn't realize
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I mean, you have to really look at it. But FBI reports also show that, FBI reports obtained under the Freedom of Information Act. They show that there was communication between the two terrorists, Khalid al-Midar and Nawaf al-Hazmi.
What's the first name, Nawaf?
Khalid al-Midar and Nawaf al-Hazmi. They were the very first two terrorists sent to the United States by Bin Laden. And they communicated very frequently to the house in Yemen for several reasons. One of them was that was Bin Laden's operations center. And the other reason was that Khalid al-Midar was married to the daughter of the person who owned the house, and she lived there. So he would call up frequently, both to talk to his wife and to talk to his wife's father, who owned the house and who was Bin Laden's key guy there. So there was a lot of communications back and forth, and NSA was intercepting that. They were eavesdropping. They've been eavesdropping on that house for years because they knew it was.
We want to go back in time in just a couple of seconds, but did you pick up exactly what the two terrorists were talking about?
Does anyone know? No, because there was never any recordings of those ever released. The NSA has recordings, but they've never made them public. So, and there's never been an investigation into this whole area. That's why, you know, despite the fact that the 9/11 Commission mentioned that these calls were made between San Diego and Yemen, they never investigated why NSA didn't pass that information on to the FBI or the CIA, why they didn't do anything with that information. They held it very tightly, and they refused to pass on any information.
Is it possible they picked it up and it sat in the file and no one ever looked at it to begin with? In other words, it was by rote and then it just sat there and no one...
Well, you know, you have to think of how what were the important targets that NSA was listening to prior to 9/11. This was Osama bin Laden was one of the key people that they were targeting. I mean, there are very few people around the world as important, even prior to 9/11, than Osama bin Laden. He'd already been indicted for the coal bombing, and you know, we already knew he was attacking the United States. So this was his operations center. So no, there were very few places in the world that were less a priority or actually there were a few places in the world that were more a priority than this house in Yemen. So whatever went on there was important, and the CIA wanted to know what went on there, and they actually went over, the head of the CIA's bin Laden unit went to the NSA and said, can we get that information?
Really?
And they refused to give
them that information?
So the CIA actually built their own intercept facility to try to pick it up. But because they didn't have any satellites.
It's like Rumsfeld established his own intelligence agency.
Well, and here you have one agency picking it up and not giving it, so the other one has to build their own intercept facility. Right. They're only getting half the conversations because they don't have any satellites to intercept it. And they go back to NSA and they say, well, we're with our own facilities, we couldn't get half of it now, but can you give us the other half? And they still refuse to give them the other half. And this is leading up to 9/11. It was a complete disaster from beginning to end.
Occurred to me one possibility. Doesn't make much sense, but I think you could theorize that the information that was going from San Diego to that house was highly domestic, because, as you say, the wife was living there. Did you say, or something to that effect?
Yeah.
So that might have been just.
But still,
why not show it?
Well, the point, who cares what it's about? The point is, it shows that these two people are in San Diego.
Right.
I mean, that they're in the United States. What are two bin Laden terrorists doing in San Diego?
Okay, well, let's show how they got to San Diego. We'll start again, actually, with an intercept from this house.
In late December 1999, NSA finds one very important dot. It intercepts an alarming call to the house in Yemen, instructing two Al-Qaeda foot soldiers to fly to Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, for what sounds like a terrorist summit. The foot soldiers are Khalid Al-Midar and Nawaf Al-Hazmi. This is the phone call that sets in motion the 9/11 attacks.
All right, now, there's the house, there's the NSA intercepting phone calls, but this is a different period of time. This is 1999, and we were just talking a few minutes ago about intercepting calls from San Diego thereafter, closer to 2001. So what's this stuff about being a summit meeting of terrorists, and the two of them are going there? Are they talking about 9/11 at the summit meeting?
Well, nobody knew. What NSA had been listening to this house for years, since probably about 1996, 1997, somewhere around that time period. That was when bin Laden first got his satellite phone. And most of the calls went to that house in Yemen. That's why they decided to begin eavesdropping on that house in Yemen. He made 221 calls to that house in Yemen.
Who made 221?
The bin Laden and his associates.
Oh, he made 221 calls. The NSA had them all?
The NSA had been intercepting it ever since he got his cell phone. They've been intercepting his phone calls.
Was that in the 9/11 report?
I'm not sure if it was referenced in the 9/11 report.
I don't remember reading what the contents of those calls were.
Well,
this one we know about, to go back where we were. This one says, go to Kuala Lumpur.
Yeah, they never released the contents of the report. I mean, bin Laden did not discuss operational issues. They were eavesdropping on that phone call, those phone calls at the same time bin Laden was actually planning the attacks on East Africa, but they were never, you know, NSA was totally in the dark of that taking place. So, but they were listening to that house for years. And then in December of 1999, one of the calls that they picked up was very interesting. It was three people, Khalid, Nawaf, and Salim, to Kuala Lumpur for a meeting.
Okay,
an important meeting.
Two of those three are the people are 9/11 terrorists. Two of the 19, right?
Three of them.
All three are three?
Salim was also, yeah.
All three were three of the 19.
Yeah, but Salim ended up not going to Kuala Lumpur. It was send these guys to Kuala Lumpur for a big meeting. So obviously, that's a big deal. Bin Laden sending these guys to Kuala Lumpur for a big meeting. Does that mean they're going to blow up Kuala Lumpur? Does that mean they're going to have a summit terrorist summit meeting. So the CIA, the NSA notified the CIA. The CIA set up surveillance there, watching these people.
Did the CIA do the surveillance himself, or did they give it someone? Give it to someone else? Do you know?
Well, they mostly gave it to the local
the local people, or
Malaysian secret police.
I've always wondered. Picture this: you got people photographing this house in which three of the 19, or yeah, three of the 19 terrorists are there, and I say to myself, plotting 9/11.
I don't know about that.
We're taking pictures of the damn thing going on.
Yeah,
that's
just, well,
that's unbelievable, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly. The well, the, again, as you mentioned, we didn't know what was going on, but we knew that something was going on. But then the problem was the CIA lost these guys. They were going, they went to the airport. They flew from Kuala Lumpur to Bangkok. And it was a Saturday. They couldn't wake the guy up, I guess, and the CIA guy up in Bangkok.
Was there a CIA guy in Kuala Lumpur, or are those just agents, do you think, of a...
No, we had the, there was a CIA station
the
there.
So the CIA guy saw the plane leave with
these
three guys on it?
Yeah, they saw him heading to the airport.
And they couldn't wake up the guy in Bangkok?
No, they never got the message to him, and it was like a Saturday,
well,
and nobody was working.
What do you mean, wake him up?
Well, it was a Saturday.
Yeah, but wake up means a phone call.
Well, they never, I don't think they ever made a phone call. They sent one of these
cables,
basically.
What does a cable mean? Cables, the reason I ask is if you read the 9/11 report, and we'll get to this in a minute again, cables are going here and there. But I say to myself, cables? I mean, in the digital age, people are sending cables?
Yeah, I know. The whole thing sounds like something out of a 1940s movie, but... you raise the important question. What's wrong with the telephone? whatever, you know, the FBI,
okay.
I'm sorry, the CIA blew it.
They lost these guys.
So they go to Bangkok. They only spend a couple of days in Bangkok. And then they get on a plane.
Two of them,
Goodale, Nawaf Al-Hazmi, get on a United Airlines flight to San Diego. They come into San Diego without any problem. They start establishing their base in San Diego.
I wonder. Then that takes us back to where we started, because they're in San Diego, and I think they're betting with an FBI agent or something, aren't they?
Yeah,
does that sound
the whole
right?
thing is almost. If it wasn't so tragic, it would almost be comical, because while they were en route to Kuala Lumpur. The CIA managed to get the, I think it was the government in Dubai, the United Arab Emirates, to secretly copy Khalid Al-Midar's passport.
And how did they do that as he was leaving?
He had to change planes in Dubai.
Oh, in Dubai. They got him to, it was in Dubai on the way to Kuala Lumpur? They're following him all the way. All the way to Kuala Lumpur, but they can't follow him.
Well,
out
they know his they know his route, because that was part of what they intercepted that in that phone call.
Yeah.
Was his itinerary.
So they alert people in Dubai.
So they told him that he's going to be coming in on this flight. His name's Khalid, and the CIA was able to come up with his last name, Khalid Al-Midar, and so he's going through. They take his passport and they make a copy of it, and then they send him on his way, and they. Send the copy of the Xerox copy of the passport to the CIA, to the CIA station chief in Dubai, and then he sends it off to CIA headquarters.
Photograph.
Yeah. And what was surprising about it to them is the fact that here's this guy, alleged terrorist from Bin Laden's operations center in Yemen. Being sent to Kuala Lumpur for a summit meeting, and what's he got in his passport? He's got an active visa to the United States.
Ooh.
And they look up and they said he's going to, he applied.
Wait a minute. It's great talking to you about this, because, you know, I've followed this, as you can see, at a distance farther away than you. But when you start pinpointing this stuff, it gets worse and worse. So the passport showed, now the passport is picked up before they get to the summit meeting. The passport shows, effectively, they're going to leave Kuala Lumpur and come to the United States.
Exactly, yeah. When, why else would you get a visa for the United States?
Okay, but now this is a photograph, right?
Yeah, it's a
well, along with a visa,
copy.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And the CIA agents are taking photographs in Kuala Lumpur, right?
Yeah, and the local intelligence service.
Here's my question. What do you think happens to the photographs? Are they put in an envelope and sent to the CIA, or are they somehow otherwise transmitted?
Well, they could transmit them by secure fax. They have, you know.
Yeah, but how about digital photos? This is a digital age.
Yeah.
Why didn't they digitalize the photos so they end up right in the system? I can't figure out whether they did or not, but it seems to me they probably.
Well, that's the whole problem. The problem here, it goes even beyond that. It's the fact that they did get the information within hours or whatever at CIA headquarters and also, you know, Kuala Lumpur. And and what I also write about in the book, I interviewed, I think I'm the only one to interview somebody that was actually in that unit at the CIA at the time. It was the FBI agent who was there. Mark Rossini, and Mark Rossini saw this information come in that there was a visa for this guy, actually for both of them, to go to the United States.
And can I just stop you there? Because I want to come back to that, but I've got this idea, this information. We got photographs, we got visas, we've got phone calls.
Yeah.
We've got, I think, probably something from the Bangkok CIA, whatever they call themselves. So that's all coming into somebody's file, right?
Yeah.
And I've never been able to figure out where the heck that file is. The CIA got the file someplace?
Yeah, the CIA had a little unit called Alex Station, which was the Bin Laden unit, and that's where everything would go in. That was the whole purpose of Alex Station. It had one purpose in life, and that was to track Bin Laden and his people. So the information came into Alex Station. It had CIA people there, and then it also had two FBI agents that were assigned. The FBI agents were saying, we want to send this information to the FBI headquarters because these guys are heading to the United States. And they ought to know, since internal U.S. security is the responsibility of the FBI. And the person at the CIA at Alex Station refused to allow them to send that to the FBI. And in our NOVA program, we interviewed the FBI agent, Mark Rossini, and I, for the Shadow Factory, my book, I interviewed him. And he said that, he was flabbergasted because here it was, information saying these guys are coming to the United States, and he's being told by the FBI, by the CIA, he can't tell the FBI about it. Ever since 9/11, I've regretted it, that I never did. But at the time, he would have been fired and lost his clearance and all that.
Well, let's ask ourselves in a second, what's going through the CIA's mind? But let's make it even worse than what you described, because that incident happened. I don't know, in July or something or other.
Well, that incident happened in January of 2000.
Oh, January of 2000.
Well, the phone call was picked up in December of 1999.
All that happened in 2000.
And beginning of January 2000, they flew to Kuala Lumpur, and that's when all this happened.
There's another incident that happens later on that year. It may have been even in 2001 earlier, where two FBI agents, I think they're different than the ones we're talking about now. I think they may be just two, quotes.
Right.
FBI agents not assigned to the CIA headquarters. And you have to remember that Mary Jo White charged and convicted 20 terrorists, all with the help of FBI investigation. An extraordinary story. But the point of the story being, FBI was heavily into this stuff.
Sure.
Okay, so for some reason, two FBI agents come up to New York to see the CIA. Why the CIA is in New York, why it's not the other around, I'm not sure. But anyway, the CIA agent is sitting there with this file, at least in his or her head, perhaps even in front. And the FBI starts asking questions about, let's say the visa or something. And the CIA sits there and does not volunteer any information that's in the file whatsoever. In other words, didn't share the information about the intercept from that house we've looked at, didn't show them those photographs in whatever form they were. They didn't tell them anything. What's going on here with the FBI and the CIA?
Well, you know, they had these enormous, there's two issues here. One of them is these enormous turf battles, and what Mark Rossini said was that when he went up to one of the officials in Alex Station, said he wanted to tell the FBI headquarters about the visa, this guy's coming to the U.S., the woman there who he was speaking with said, look, the next attack is going to happen in Southeast Asia or South Asia someplace. It's not going to happen in the U.S. So when we want the FBI to know about it, we'll tell the FBI about it. Until then, it's, you know, this is our jurisdiction. So this was turf. It had only to do with turf. They didn't want the FBI messing with the CIA, even though these guys were coming to the United States, which is not the CIA's territory. It's the FBI's territory. So it was this jurisdictional turf battles going on. In New York, it was similar, although there were more issues in the New York meeting of this thing called the wall. The wall was this bureaucratic fiction, but what it was a there were the way the laws were written, the intelligence people couldn't pass on certain intercept information to law enforcement. Because of it's a very complicated thing, but the reason was because these were national security eavesdropping wiretaps, FISA wiretaps, which are easier to get than regular criminal wiretaps, and there was a worry that people that the FBI would if it was hard to get a regular warrant for a tap, they would go for the easier FISA warrant. And so there was restrictions put on the transfer of that information. That changed after 9/11. So that was part of that issue.
The idea would be that the CIA may have had access to certain information that ordinarily the FBI wouldn't have access to.
There's two parts of the FBI. There's the intelligence part of the FBI, and then there's the law enforcement side of the FBI. The CIA, there would be no problem whatsoever with the CIA sharing that information with the intelligence part of the FBI.
Right.
There were restrictions on sharing it with law enforcement because then they would have to, if they went into court, they'd have to.
But they overblew their idea of what the wall was. That's not the nice way to describe it. They built the wall larger and taller and thicker than they should have.
And they used the wall as an excuse for turf battles to a large degree.
Okay, so now let's get to the question of whether we can solve this problem. Recently, Michael Hayden, who was head of the NSA and appears prominently in your book, was effectively quoted as follows. This is from the Wall Street Journal. U.S. spy agencies' sensitive data should soon be linked by Google-like search systems, nearly 5 years after the intelligence community was rebuked by the 9/11 Commission for failing to connect the dots and detect the attack. The impact for analysts, Mr. Connolly says, will be staggering. So let's set this up by just reviewing what we've been through. Many times we've shown that the CIA had information. And so the question would be, if they had it, why the hell wasn't, excuse my language, why wasn't it in the computer so that everyone could access it?
Well, that's an excellent question, and that's what a lot of people asked. If this was a corporation, they would have thought of this a long time ago. If it's McDonald's, you want all the McDonald's to be able to get the same communications at the same time. But this is sort of this fiefdom where each agency had its own computer system, their own databases. And they were not only not linked, they were almost unlinkable because they were, you know, totally incompatible. You had no information technologist at the top coordinating everybody's purchase of technology. So one person would buy Apple, another person would buy PCs and, you know, that kind of thing. So you have incompatible software, incompatible hardware. and everybody doing their own thing and not being able to intercommunicate. That was the problem. There was one sort of link that should have linked everybody.
It's called Interlink.
Interlink, yeah. Interlink. But the FBI would never put its stuff on.
When in fact, this stuff wasn't put on. You know, the Kuala Lumpur photographs, if in fact they were digitalized, was never put on Interlink.
Right.
So that leads to the question. Mr. McConnell says, hey, we're in great, you know, we're finally in great shape. You know, digital age begins in 1995 when this program starts. And here we are X years later. And finally, we're going to link, says McConnell. And everything is going to be fine. Is everything going to be fine or not?
Well, I've heard that so many times. I mean, how many times have you heard the FBI say, "Oh, we're all set now. We're all digitalized. All our systems are compatible." Then you get a GAO report that says everything's falling apart, nothing's connected, or whatever. So I'll believe it when I see it. I hope they're making progress. I mean, you know, what more do you need? You got 7-8 years now since 9/11. So
the question is, you're an NSA intelligence expert, okay? We've set up a couple of situations when people were sitting on information and they wouldn't, if that's what they were doing back then, physically pass it.
Yeah.
Or if it was all in the computer, which I somewhat doubt, it's all put in some way, no one can retrieve it.
Or they're too lazy to go after
too lazy. Okay,
what
now we take,
NSA.
Okay, now we take the same person. Now we're X more years into the digital age. Is that person's attitude toward that information going to be different now than it was today? In other words, I'm not going to share it with you yesterday for whatever reason, but now that I'm in the digital age, I will share it. Is the answer still, when I see it, I believe it? What do you think
is there
a change in culture here,
I think,
or not?
There's less turf battles now. I mean, the shock of 9/11, I think, was enormous shock to the system of the whole intelligence community. I think, but I still, some of the people I talk to are still leery of other people's, getting credit for something they did. That's one of the key things. If the NSA is working on something, they're afraid that somebody at CIA is going to say, here's a CIA report, and this is with a big seal of the CIA on it, and when it was actually the work of the NSA.
So we've come to the end. Was it a digital failure? And will the new system cure the failure?
It was a digital failure among many failures, yes. Okay. Whether it'll cure it, I have no idea.
No idea. Thanks, Jim, for coming by.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming by. Come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I'm James Goodale, and have a good week.